Good morning. The first item of business is general questions. And as ever, I would appreciate succinct questions and answers to match in order to get in as many members as possible. And those members seeking a supplementary should press the request to speak button during the relevant question. And at question number one, I call Liz Smith.
To ask the Scottish Government what its policy is in relation to employment-based routes to teacher training.
Minister Graeme Day.
The Scottish Government is supportive of a range of university-based routes into teaching, and we are open to working with our university providers to consider alternative routes which lead to an appropriate teaching qualification. The member will be aware that we offer bursaries for career changers wishing to become teachers in our most hard-to-fill subject. It is, however, the General Teaching Council for Scotland that determines what constitutes a recognised teaching qualification.
Liz Smith.
Can I thank Mr Day for that answer? I'm asking the question because of concerns that have been expressed to me amongst those who have been working with the University of Buckingham as mentors to PGCE students, that this may be the last year that the University of Buckingham offers its very highly regarded and rigorous training course in Scotland. And allegedly that's because of changes to Scottish Government policy on employment-based routes into teacher training. So can I ask the Minister for some verification on this, and if he could provide me with details about what's actually happened here?
Minister.
The University of Buckingham offering was at no time an employment route into teaching as such. It was a transitional arrangement which followed the requirement for teachers working in the independent school sector to be registered with the GTCS, which was introduced in 2017. The University of Buckingham delivered a top-up programme to enable that to happen, but it was only accredited for a small category of teachers with a limited timescale in which to complete that. I hope that provides Liz Smith with sufficient clarity, but if it doesn't, if I haven't quite captured the essence of her question, I'm more than happy to engage with her further on that.
And supplementary, Martin Whitfield.
I'm very grateful, Deputy Presiding Officer. Can the Minister confirm that the Scottish Government is still committed to a graduate teaching profession?
Minister.
I'll say to the member that the Scottish Government is absolutely committed to the teaching profession, full stop, but it will always engage with opportunities to universities to see how we enhance that further.
And a supplementary from Willie Rennie, who is joining us online. Mr Rennie.
The Minister will know that I'm concerned about the high levels of unemployment, but also short-term contracts in the teaching profession. And this won't be particularly attractive to those who are looking to switch career into teaching. What is the Minister doing about recruiting the 3,500 extra teachers promised, but also the reduction in teacher contact time that will be essential to recruit those extra teachers?
Minister.
President Officer, as Mr Rennie knows, this is not my area of responsibility, but I'm more than happy to write back to him in full detail on that, although I do know he had an exchange with the Cabinet Secretary in the Chamber not so long ago, where I think she answered this quite fully.
Question number two, Evan Tweed.
To ask the Scottish Government what support it is providing to local authorities to ensure that any subsidised bus routes are maintained.
Minister Fiona Hislop.
Local authorities receive funding from the Scottish Government via the General Revenue Grant and have a duty to consider supporting socially necessary services which are otherwise not commercially viable. In 2021-22, local authorities spent £55 million supporting bus services in this way.
Evelyn Tweed.
Stirling Council have recently launched their budget consultation, which includes three options for public transport, all of which would see cuts to the subsidised X10 and C60 service, vital in linking Stirling's rural communities. To ask the Scottish Government what conversations take place with local authorities to ensure there is an awareness of the importance of the provision of bus services in rural areas.
Minister.
Under the Transport Act 1985, local authorities have a duty to identify where there is a social need for particular bus services and can subsidise these at their discretion. This means that local transport authorities can provide subsidy for services that are not provided on a commercial basis, but this is entirely a matter for the local authority to determine, and the Scottish Government has no powers to intervene in these matters. Transport Scotland Act 2019, local transport authorities now have powers enabling them to run their own services. These powers sit alongside their existing powers to subsidise local services. However, it's not for local transport authority to decide if they want to use these powers. It's for them to decide whether they want to use these powers to improve services. And I did discuss rural transport bus issues with the regional transport partnerships only this week.
Supplementary, Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. The M2 bus that runs from Tory Glen to Castlemilk in my region is an hourly service regularly used by older people and the only bus that serves the bottom of Spittal and Dunure Dyve. For the past month, it's reduced to an hourly service and recently to no service at all due to repairs, because it's taken over a month for that and no replacement. So can I ask the Minister, what can she do to establish why this has gone on so long, and what mechanism can she put in place to ensure replacement services are there and now and in the future?
Minister.
I'm sure the member will be aware that the bus services are either run by commercial operators in the deregulated market or, as we've just discussed, subsidised by the local authority, but again run by private companies. I do appreciate, and this is general across all transport areas, that repairs and replacement of parts is having pressure on all transport issues. But these are best placed by her as MSP, making representations on behalf of her constituents directly with the bus company. And if she's not met with the bus company, I strongly encourage her to do so.
And supplementary, Mark Ruskell.
Thank you. Can I ask the Minister about the importance of local political leadership here? Because my understanding is that Stirling Council have had money from the Community Bus Fund to develop new local rural services, and that Loughlin and the Trossachs National Park are also committed to establishing new routes, working with the Council, and that's going to be included in the forthcoming park plan. So it seems that all the ingredients are there to restore rural bus services. What's lacking is the local political leadership to pull it all together and use the new powers in the Transport Act.
Minister.
Well, it's disappointing to hear that bus services are deteriorating in the Stirling area. It is a matter for local political leadership, just as it's a matter for national political leadership to put transport front and centre in terms of priorities. Anybody who has got any concerns about private operators can obviously approach the Traffic Commissioner as well. But also in terms of providing tools for enabling, we've got the 2019 Act, a whole suite of different regulations coming into force, are already in force, giving more powers and responsibilities for local authorities to use. And the Community Bus Fund is intended to support local transport authorities in considering the Act powers and to improve local services. And over
Thank you, Minister. We'll need to move to the next question. Monica Lennon, question number four, please.
To ask the Scottish Government what its priorities are for COP28.
Cabinet Secretary Mary McCallum.
Presiding Officer, in summary, our principal objectives for COP28 are that our leadership on loss and damage builds momentum for urgent funding, that our co-chairmanship of the Under 2 Coalition supports action and commitments, that our commitment to low carbon energy under a just transition to net zero, particularly around offshore wind and hydrogen, can influence others to do more to achieve net zero, and that we will advance international relationships, attract investment in Scotland and enhance Scotland's global reputation, particularly on renewable energy. And we will also continue using our platform to platform the voices of women, young people and the Global South in COP28 debate and action.
Monica Lennon.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for her response. Now that the European Union has decided to criminalise offences comparable to ecocide, will the Scottish Government take the opportunity at COP28 to meet with governments and campaigners who are advancing ecocide law in light of the Government's commitment to maintain alignment with the EU on environmental protection?
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I welcome Monica Lennon's question. I have a very full programme indeed at COP28, which includes a number of meetings centering on that twin crisis of nature loss. The Scottish Government is absolutely committed to protecting Scotland's environment. Monica Lennon is right to recognise the progress at EU level. We will assess the final revised EU Environmental Crime Directive against our own policy to seek to maintain alignment where we can with EU law. And I will, of course, take this important matter into a number of the conversations that I'll be having at COP28.
And supplementary, Karen Adam.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The climate credentials of the current UK government are in absolute tatters, and the only thing the Labour government in waiting seem capable of is flip-flopping and U-turns. How can Scotland work with the international community at COP28 to try and effect a positive outcome and show the world that our views and ambitions for the future of the planet are not represented by Westminster?
Cabinet Secretary.
Karen Adam is absolutely right to point out how much of a leader Scotland is already recognised as in the climate space, not only in our own commitments and our actions, particularly on renewables and nature-based solutions, but equally on our pursuit of climate justice. We will be using our platform at COP. The First Minister is already there. I will follow as he returns home. But The point is that no nation has all the answers or the means to respond at the scale that's required. That's why national leadership and representation at fora like COP28 is so important, and Scotland will use its role to our full potential.
Question number 5, Finlay Carson.
To ask the Scottish Government what funding it is providing for regeneration and economic renewal projects in the south of Scotland.
Cabinet Secretary Neil Gray.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Our place-based investment programme has directly provided over £18 million to councils in the south of Scotland region since 2021, and the area has received over £48 million from other Scottish Government regeneration funding programmes. The Scottish Government is also investing £85 million in the Borderlands deal and £300 million in the Edinburgh and South East Scotland deal, supporting a wide range of projects and programmes designed to stimulate economic growth. In addition, we have allocated over £34 million to the South of Scotland Enterprise Agency in 23-24 to support economic and community development across the region.
Finlay Carson.
Yeah, I thank the Cabinet Secretary for his response. I would also recognise the funding the UK Government's Levelling Up Fund has brought to projects like the Georgetel and Stranraer. The Cabinet Secretary may be aware that in April 2016, the Scottish Government committed to invest £6 million towards the regeneration of Stranraer when the ferry port closed. Unfortunately, previous SNP Labour administrations at Dumfries and Galloway Council and the Scottish Government have failed to deliver a process to draw down this money, despite knowing that this investment could bring transformational change, jobs and opportunities for local people. Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary what discussions he's had with the current administration and what progress has been made to draw down this money?
Cabinet Secretary.
So we have been in constant dialogue with Dumfries and Galloway Council and made it clear that we cannot release funds in this space in the absence of detailed proposals. Officials met with the council representatives on the 13th of November to discuss Stranraer's place plan and underlined the need for them to develop and submit detailed investment proposals for us to consider. Stranraer has already benefited from £2.8 million from the Regeneration Capital Grant Fund. We have also committed £16 million through the Borderlands Growth Deal to support the redevelopment of Stranraer Marina, focused on creating new jobs and drawing in new visitors to the area. So I hope that gives Mr Carson some reassurance.
Supplementary, Emma Harper.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I've previously raised regeneration and economic renewal in terms of addressing the many vacant, abandoned and derelict sites across South Scotland, like the Arches in Stranraer and the Interfloor factory in Dumfries. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree that it's crucial that funding to address derelict sites ensures that rural areas like D&G are included, and will he agree to meet with me to discuss how these sites can be better addressed?
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer, and I thank Emma Harper for that question. Yes, I'm happy to meet Emma Harper to discuss that and to discuss the fact that the vacant and derelict land investment programme is open to all local authorities, including those in the south of Scotland and Dumfries and Galloway, to apply and to assist them in being able to tackle the persistence of vacant and derelict land in the areas that they are covering.
Question number 6, Alec Riley.
Presiding Officer, to ask the Scottish Government what action it will take to increase the use of buses across Scotland.
Minister Fiona Hislop.
Earlier this year, we co-funded a successful national marketing campaign with bus operators, encouraging people to return to bus or use it for the first time. The campaign reached an audience of millions, prompted over 32,000 visits to the choosethebus.scot website, and increased older and disabled persons' concessionary journeys by 5.8% during the campaign period. Additionally, our concessionary travel schemes provide access to free bus travel to over 2 million people in Scotland, including around 170,000 people in Fife, with over 3 million journeys every week. These schemes help people cut costs, making sustainable travel a more attractive option.
Alec Riley.
While I have repeatedly welcomed the under-22 bus pass scheme in this chamber, I have also repeatedly raised the issue of unaffordable and ever-increasing bus fares for those without the benefit of a concessionary scheme. The UK Government has introduced a blanket cap of £2 to all bus fares in England to help tackle the issue during the cost of living crisis. Will the Minister examine the case and cost for a similar fare cap in Scotland that would benefit all bus users?
Minister.
Well, the rest of the UK don't have the generous concessionary bus scheme that Scotland has, with over 2 million of our population benefiting from it. However, the member makes an important point about working people who can't afford the bus fares that wouldn't be eligible for the concessionary schemes. And it's why our Fair Fares Review, which is due to report shortly, is looking at the balance of this and how do we ensure that if we're tackling poverty, one of the biggest blights that we see as a result of successive Westminster governments is in-work poverty, and anything this government can do to help relieve it, we can. But let's be realistic. The budget that we are facing is very serious indeed if we are want to achieve what he and I want to do, is tackle poverty properly in Scotland.
Supplementary, Graeme Simpson.
Thank you very much. And just to follow up on that point, I think that the Minister is perhaps missing an opportunity here, because we could have a Scottish bus fare cap if she chose to examine it. So to ask her again, is she prepared to at least look at the proposal and look at what it might cost?
Minister.
Well, the member makes an important point, but he also, I think, fails to reflect that Scotland does not have a centralised system in terms of what can be done in local authority areas. We're in the process of bringing through the regulations that will give more powers, for example, over franchising, and powers over running of services are already there. So unless he wants to centralise all decision-making on transport, then I think that would be problematic in our context. However, I met with the Regional Transport Partnership, which includes transport partnerships from across Scotland, and I think all of us, whether it's in local authorities, regional transport partnerships, or indeed in the national government, are thinking about how we can do things in a better way. But I don't think centralising everything, as he's suggesting, may be the route forward that our councils and local authorities would want.
Question number 7, Martin Whitfield.
I'm very grateful to ask the Scottish Government what recent discussions it's had with East Lothian Council regarding the future of local public service provision in the area, including in relation to the Lock Centre in Trinet.
Minister Joe Fitzpatrick.
Thank you. The Scottish Government places great importance on community sports and leisure facilities, and the Deputy First Minister met with representatives of East Lothian Council on 23rd of August. We are fully aware that local councils, like all public authorities, are facing challenging financial circumstances, and that's why we increased the resources available to local government by over £793 million in 2023-24. 2023-24, East Lothian Council will receive £221.5 million to fund local services, which equates to an extra £8.1 million to support vital day-to-day services, or an additional 3.8% compared to 2022-23.
Martin Whitfield.
I'm very, very grateful for the response. The IPSAH's sixth priority of the eight investments that work for physical activity states that sport and recreation opportunities must target audiences where the need may be greatest or participation rates are at their lowest. And the Scottish Government agrees with this. The Lock Centre in Trinet does exactly this. Does the Minister agree with me that while it is right and proper that local authorities decide how local funding is distributed to its communities and in turn decide how to provide and maintain community and sporting facilities, they must have the political and practical support from the Government to meet this need properly?
Minister.
I think the member makes a very strong point. The benefits of physical activity and sport as part of that is huge across our country, and it is really important that we all work together. So local authorities, Scottish Government, Sport Scotland, working hand in hand, we absolutely understand the particular challenges that we face in terms of the estate. That's why the Sport Scotland have been tasked with doing a piece of work to look at facilities across Scotland in terms of how they can be sustainable in the long term. It's also why the government's programme for government mentioned a working group working with our partners in COSLA and Sport Scotland to look at how we can better use all of that estate, particularly the schools estate, where we can see in many occasions is the best facility located in a community but is often inaccessible to members of that community. So we need to do more, but we need to do it in partnership.
Thank you, Minister. I can squeeze in question number 8 if I have succinct questions and answers. Question number 8, Dr. Gilhani joining us remotely.
To ask the Scottish Government what recent discussions this has had with Glasgow City Council and Glasgow Life regarding the future provision of public services and facilities in the region, including the Glasgow National Hockey Centre.
Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Scottish Government are fully aware of local authorities are facing challenging financial circumstances, particularly in maintaining and operation of facilities, largely due to energy costs and other costs of living pressures. The Scottish Government will continue to meet with COSLA and individual local authorities on a regular basis to cover a range of topics, including current and future budget processes. It is vital that all avenues are explored to ensure, where possible, that local clubs and communities have access to sport and leisure facilities.
Dr. Gohani.
I'm sure the Minister will be aware that the Hockey Centre in Glasgow is a 2014 Commonwealth Games legacy venue, and a question mark now hangs over the future of the viability of the facility. Scottish Hockey has a potential investor, but I'm told that progress has been slow due to inactivity on the part of Glasgow Life. No one wants to lose potential investment in a valuable sporting venue in Glasgow. So will the Minister intervene to ensure the future of the facility and the many clubs which use it?
Minister.
The member, I'm sure, will be well aware that Glasgow, like other local authorities, are democratically elected institutions, and it is absolutely appropriate that important that this Parliament respects the democratic mandates of our local councillors across Scotland. In terms of the specifics in terms of Scottish Hockey, I know that Scottish Hockey have written to the Minister for Sport, and a response will be coming to Scottish Hockey in due course.
Thank you, Minister. That concludes general questions, and we will now move on to the next item of business, which is First Minister's questions.